Hi guys. So I was going to run another episode this week, but in honor of Danny Aiello, who died last week, I just felt like I wanted to rerun this. It hasn't been that long. It's only been a couple of months, but I just feel so lucky to have known him. He was such a spectacular person, and I just felt like I wanted to do it in his honor. A lot of the people I interview are very special to me. Danny, by far, was super, super special. He was as real, honest, personable, creative, reflective, fun, talented, and loving, I think, as people come. And I know he loved his family so deeply, his friend Louis, his lifelong friend, and I'm sure so many other people who knew him well feel a big void right now and forever will, because he took up a lot of space in the very best way. I mean that in the very best way. I feel so lucky to have known him. Here's my conversation, my most recent conversation with Danny Aiello. It took place over the summer. This is Really Famous. I'm Kara Mayer Robinson, and I interview famous people, but I don't just interview them like your typical interview. I'm not really interested in those same old questions. Instead, I like to know who they really are and what they really think. This is my brand new interview with Danny Aiello. Danny Aiello, of course, delivered incredible performances in movies like Do the Right Thing, Moonstruck, Ready to Wear, The Last Don, City Hall, 29th Street, and one of his first movies, The Godfather Part II. The first time Danny was on the show was in December 2017. If you didn't hear that episode, go listen to that first. I actually reached out to Danny a few months ago to see if he'd do a short video with me. I've been expanding into video interviews with celebs for my YouTube channel. And as I was putting together a highlight reel, I really wanted him to be part of it because he is definitely one of my favorites. We hit it off right away. He's honest. He's real. You know how much I like that in a person. Long story short, he said yes, but it took a while to get it off the ground. We were trying to set this up for months. First, I was going to meet him on set of a new movie that he's starring in. More on that in a second. I was going to interview him in his trailer during breaks, but then that ended up not working out, so we did it at his hotel. You'll hear his rep and lifelong friend, Louis. He's with us, and he is the one who set the whole thing up. So it was in sort of like a non-private part of the hotel, so there is some occasional interference. It's not really interference. It's just you can hear people like actually walking in and out of a door nearby, but no worries. And you will also hear Louis chiming in here and there because that's the way it goes with Danny and Louis. So the new film is called One Moment. Danny is the lead actor. It's a comedy written and directed by Deirdre O'Connor. Danny plays the dad of grown children who are struggling to figure out how to take care of him as he's aging. The official release date has yet to be determined, but it will probably be later this year or early 2020. So, as you'll see, as I talk to Danny for the second time, we find plenty of new things to talk about. And now that I know him better, I guess I'm comfortable enough to start analyzing him as well. So you'll hear his reaction to that. And instead of just talking for a few minutes, which was the original plan, we keep going and going. You'll hear me jump in just to reset the video because the video shuts off every so often. And now, Danny Aiello returns to Really Famous. I don't like my profile either. Please, I hate to be. No, I don't care.
I have a Roman profile.
Well,
I don't care.
You're beautiful, but
sure.
I don't like to be your profile. Beautiful.
The only way I can be beautiful is with surgical tools. You are beautiful.
You are beautiful.
Yeah, sure.
Please.
I love you.
But so. I hate to see. But I don't even like to see myself on camera. So I have to set it up, and I get it. I have to be on. Am I on? Am I in frame? I am.
I hate seeing myself
Do
in
you
pictures.
Really?
I'm shocked when it comes back good news. I'm saying, are they serious? What are they looking at?
Oh, please. No, it's good. True. You have to do it. You look good. So I have pictures of the two of us in your dressing room.
Yeah, I remember. And, I got it too.
Yeah, it was great.
I have as well.
Yeah, I absolutely love that talk.
Yeah,
so since then, I have to tell you, I got your book, and I, because we booked that a few days before, so I didn't have time to read your book.
Right.
But then I read it after, so I know all about you now, and you too, because you're in the book. So there.
Yeah.
I'm like, oh wait, hold on, I know Louie. Oh, it's in there. I brought it for you to sign.
Oh,
because I gotta have you sign. But we can do it after. It's fine.
Yeah, I'll do it.
So by the way, so here we are. Is it on or in Long Island? It's on, right? On Long
yeah,
Island?
Yeah, I think it's in Long Island. We call
in
it
Long
in
Island?
Long Island, but I suppose it is on. Right, Lou?
Yeah.
But meanwhile, you and I live right near each other. I just found out.
Where?
Okay, in the interest of privacy, I cut out the minute or two of us describing where we both live. Let's just say we live very close to each other. Here's where we picked up again.
Well, this is my get out. You know, being that I'm getting older now, even when I was younger, when I go to California to do a movie, I hated going there. But naturally, they would pay, you know, they'd take me there, they would house me and pay me a lot of money, and then I couldn't wait to get home. And when I got home, I was a dead man. No, I'm a boring
what
son
do you
of
mean?
A. Oh, man,
you just
I'm dead.
Totally
I do nothing.
So, what do you do?
I read scripts and I do memory work with myself, not for any medicinal purposes, but I like to come on a script knowing the entire script and everything I'm saying, because I've seen too many embarrassing moments with actors who had aged, and I'm sitting there and they can't remember a line, and I said I can never see myself hopefully doing that. The embarrassment of not remembering lines is terrible. So it's like Carnegie Hall. How do you learn to play? You work, you practice. So all I do is read scripts. I read scripts and I memorize them. I got four of them in my head right now, amounting to maybe 350 pages, Louis. I can quote things from any of the four pages, but that's wonderful.
It is wonderful. That,
but those are the only things I do.
All right. But if you like doing it, and look what it does for you too, because you know, as you get older, you do want to do those things, and they keep you on top of everything.
It's cool when I'm down. I don't need any of that when I'm on the stage, because there's very brief things that I say, and they're truly not remembered in any way. I just arbitrarily come out with words that might be spoken on the stage. I may have a feeling at the moment and say it, so I don't have to follow a script. I'm talking about when I'm singing.
Okay.
That's relatively simple, and sometimes maybe a little difficulty with some of the songs. Not often. I'm all brand new songs now, and you know, I have the new album out. I don't know. I didn't have the album out when
you had a Christmas album, and so you. It was Christmas when I saw you. So
well, that
you
was a Christmas album.
Yes.
I think.
So you even have a song that I got to play for everybody at the end of our episode, which is great. It was so good. Like I would love to hear the new music you have.
Yeah. Well, I will give you. I don't have the album. We'll send it to her.
We'll send it. Send it. Just
we'll
an MP3,
send
and I can put
we'll
it.
We'll send you a bunch of them. We got six albums.
Okay.
So
cool.
The last one is called Hanging Out. It's like what we're doing now, hanging
there's
out.
There's nothing better than hanging out.
We got some blues numbers in it, which is what I like to do. The songs of the past I love, but they said nothing to me. So now I do blues songs because they're acted songs, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
It isn't about singing, it's about letting people understand that the words are meaningful, you know, to me.
So it's a story that comes out
story,
that you're really telling.
And I'm doing a lot of those kinds of songs now, you know. And I like You Too. I like With or Without You. I don't know if you know that song.
Of course. What?
I also I sing that. And I also did one, Shallow.
That's right, Shallow.
And we put it together where I'm singing with Gaga.
Oh, wait, what do you mean?
No, we have a voice, and because we're doing the practice tape.
Oh, okay.
So I'm doing Bradley's part. You know, and she comes in and sings, and we're singing together. And the reason we did that is because Nikki Vallelongo, who wrote Green Book, wonderful Academy Award-winning picture, apparently is doing another movie, and of course he wanted me to do it for a long time. He got hot with this movie, so it's possible that he'll be able to do this movie. And he has me as a father, owning a nightclub or something and being a, whatever it is, you know. So we were practicing because I love Gaga.
Of course,
and
she's
why do
incredible.
I love her? She's my double for my granddaughter, Sydney. She looks exactly like her. Am I right, Louie? I looked at that girl on the screen and I said, that's my granddaughter. I couldn't believe it, the same face, the same eyes.
What does Sydney do?
Sydney was a wonderful actress at that day school.
Oh, okay.
And she gave it up. She's 21 years old. I said to her, why don't you go into acting? You're going to regret this someday, not try.
Why didn't she?
I don't know. I can't talk her into it.
Really? That's
unless,
so funny.
Of course, I put her into one of my movies. We have a movie which is based on my life. It's called Somebody Else. And hopefully, if God willing, Louie, we could be doing it this year. I have to start her. And she's delicious, she's beautiful, and she's not afraid, and there's something
so
about her.
So she's confident?
Oh, yeah.
So she gets some, she knows who she is.
Oh, she knows who she is, absolutely. And my daughter is very talented, she's a spin class expert.
So she's local near us, too.
Yeah, and she's great, and she's confident in what she does, but not as confident as her daughter. Her daughter is confident.
All right, so we have to get her into that movie next
yes,
time.
Yes, we have to.
It's now or never, I'm telling you.
It's now or never. That's it.
that's a beautiful song, too.
Are we actually working now?
Yeah, we're working.
I love it.
This is how
use
I do
use what
it.
You want.
This
oh,
is what
man.
I do. To me,
this
it's
is
regular
great.
Conversation.
Ah, this is great. I love it. Yeah.
I just want to talk. And last time, that's what we did. And that's
yeah,
what I like
forgot,
to do.
I
so
forgot,
like, let's not
you.
Have a formal interview. Let's
good.
Talk about whatever happens.
And then you ask me questions, whatever.
Yeah, I ask questions that pop into my head based on what you're talking about.
Gotcha, babe.
So one of the things I'm going to tell you, I asked you something last time, and what you just said about Sophia reminded me, I asked you, it's a question I do like to ask a lot of people, which is, what's the image people have of you? Like people who don't really know you personally, who do they think Danny Aiello is?
Wow, you know, I'm not a social person with social media and things of that nature. To me, it's a very dangerous thing. For some people taking advantage in very bad ways and really affecting other people who they may be writing and saying things about. I don't like to see bad things about myself. You know, I don't like to. And I always had the feeling in social media people will tell you exactly what they feel about
and
you.
And like worse.
Because they don't have to face you.
Yeah, there's no filter because they...
Unless it's Instagram or something, but ordinarily.
Yeah, by the way, Instagram, I'm just going to stick up for Instagram.
No, I don't know it. You know.
I think Instagram is positive and friendly.
Great.
And like what I get from fans of my show is all positive, not all,
right,
but
right.
It's all, the nice things they say,
yes.
It's upbeat. It's not like the others. So
well, let me tell you, Claudia, yeah. Louie's wife, I don't do any tweet, right, Louie? I'm not a tweeter.
Yeah,
I don't
who tweets me, though? Because you have an account.
She sends me. Well, that's my
not
agent, but my...
Stacy.
So who's Stacy?
You met her first. That's how you...
She Crazy. Does things for me in a way that, to be honest with you, I never answer the tweet. She does, arbitrarily, she does things herself. But Claudia sends me all my tweets. Now, I don't know if she's deciphering those things and saying what's bad or good, but apparently
like Claudia
everything...
Claudia sends him the tweets that he feels
well, she
like.
Does. She treats me, sends me all good ones. And I keep thinking, I think maybe...
I think it's positive well, for you. I can't
if I tell you...
I can't imagine that
if
there's
I
negative.
Tell you the tweets that she sent, they're fantastic.
Yeah.
I begin to be... This is me?
Yeah.
Because whenever something happens to me in this business, I might have told you before, I often said, how good could it be if I got it? You know?
You're crazy.
But I've always been that way. And that's why my book was called I Only Know Who I Am When I Am Somebody Else. Because I was never able to truly enjoy a compliment the way people should. I should just take it and that's it. Leonardo DiCaprio, Leonardo. We were at this function in Brooklyn. And this happens to me all the time, and I can't figure it out. Sometimes I think people are taking advantage, making fun in their own way. The first one, I'll mention James Gandolfini, may he rest in peace. He used to come to me every so often, and if I'm in a place, he'd walk over to me, and he would bow to me. He would genuflect and said, I honor you.
That's in your book. I read that. Yes.
This is Jim.
Yes.
This is a true story. All right, now let's go to Bradley Cooper. We went to see his movie, Sniper, whatever it
American
was.
American Sniper.
And we're sitting there, and we're about 20 rows back, and Bradley's up there being interviewed by the director of that movie. And Louis
Clint
and I
Eastwood.
Are sitting in with a crowd of people, and I looked at Louis, I said, this guy is looking at me. I'm talking about Bradley. Now, I'm maybe 50 feet in the back, and I'm saying, this guy's looking at me. Anyway, they finished their personal interview with the people, and he walks up. When we start to walk out, he comes running after me, and he says, I honor you. I loved you in
Jacob's Ladder.
In Jacob's Ladder, when you quoted Nietzsche. That was that. Leonardo DiCaprio. Last year, a year and a half ago,
yeah.
We're at this huge party, all Italian millionaires. Uh-huh. Every one of them.
Whose party is this?
It was in Brooklyn. It was Bomonti's restaurant.
Oh, okay.
And the guy that you know, Vinnie Viola, is the man who was, he was Wall Street, big finance man. Trump had him as the army representative, but he gave it up. He said he couldn't do it. He was too busy.
Okay.
He's a very wealthy, wealthy guy. So he throws these parties. He had this party for an ex-Met. And I'm in the middle by myself. I think I was the only actor there, with the exception of Leonardo walks in, and he's taking pictures. He's sitting down. We're in the middle by ourselves eating, crowded restaurant. And Louis says to me, Leonardo DiCaprio's over there. He's taking pictures of you. I said, of me?
Wait, of you? And you
what
didn't realize
what the hell
would
he want to do me for?
Yeah.
What, me? So he said, yeah, Louis. And then a man who looks like Salvador Dali with a mustache, and he comes over to Nagdani, Mistaiello. Leonardo would like to load your autograph or something like that. He walks over and asks me, and I'm saying, what? So I told Louis, I said, well, anyway, there's a Monsignor who's at the entrance of the place who I knew, who at the beginning of the party was there. He said, Danny, before you say go tonight, would you say goodbye? I said, yes, I'll stop by. I get up prematurely out of that table after all these things happen with Leonardo, and I start walking toward the Monsignor. Leonardo apparently thinks I'm going and starts running after me. Are you ready for this?
Yeah.
Louis with me, and he stops me and he starts saying, I loved you. You made me cry in Once Around. And he's starting to compliment me where I'm getting embarrassed. So I jump up. I said, I loved you in Aviator. You were great in Gangs of New York. So this is generally what I do. When a person starts hitting me with
you
those
slam
things,
you,
I stop it. And then we got pictures of it. He'll show
That's
you.
So
Louis
cool.
will show you. But it happens to me constantly.
Of course. You're very lovable and you're an inspiration. So you're an inspiration on the screen.
Wow.
And at the same time, I feel like your personality comes through too. You know what I mean? Like you can tell that you are who you are. And right away, you are who you are.
But I don't know who I am.
Yeah, but I think that you do. I think that you do. Yes. I know that's the name of your book. I'm not going to argue with whoever
came up
with the title.
It's very interesting. I'll just stop after saying this. When I'm playing a character, quite naturally I know who I am because I investigate the character. I find out where he's from in my own head. That's making it up. And I know the words, but the words of somebody else have written for me. Mm-hmm. And I actually recite those words that are written for me, so it's not me. But I understand that is me at that particular time playing a character. Outside of that, I doubt myself so many times. I'm saying, yeah, who am I really? What do I really feel about this? And I questioned myself since I was a child because I had so many uncertainties as a child. When I was 6 and 7 years old, I was placed in the first row in my classrooms because the parents, the people loved me. The actors, the teachers loved me and put me in the front. And I was also small. And I was terrified by being in the front because I had to scratch myself all the time. And why? I had eczema, and eczema was terrible at the particular time. I would rip myself apart. I'm talking about scratching myself all over myself. It affected me so badly that it hurt my personality. It hurt my ability to be able to speak with other people. And the only time that I was safe was because I was a great reader. I could read, and that reading, for some reason, I had no idea then, took me away from myself. I was I was a structured reader. I knew what I was doing. And when I was in the front and the teacher would ask me to read, I would get up and read. But if they asked me a question, I was helpless. My personality was, I left school early in life and joined the Army at the age of 17 because I was 2 years behind. And why was I 2 years behind? Because of eczema. I was hospitalized twice and lost 2 years in school. So I was in school 2 years older than kids who were younger than me, and I was like a schmuck, excuse my language, sitting there in the school 2 years older than everyone else. So I left and joined the Army at 17. But
that's still with you, that experience for you, of
always,
the self-doubt.
Always has been, yes.
So still to this day, even after all of the success and all of the accolades from your peers.
Yes.
And
all the awards. I got a, God knows, major awards. I don't know. Louis knows better than me. I think it's 34 major acting awards.
That's huge.
And I'm talking things. I'm talking about this, that. I'm Golden Globe. I'm Academy Award. There were so many things. And even when I got it, why was I not able to be joyful?
Yeah.
Why was I not be able to, oh, wow,
It's too bad. But you weren't able to do it even for a minute, and then you stop yourself, or even the whole time you feel like you could never feel joy.
You know, I have a beautiful wife, Sandy, who I've been married to my whole life. It's the only woman that I've been with. And I think if she was an outward person capable of telling, because she's like me, she's a Gemini, she can't express her feelings. I mean, she cannot say you were great last night. That's the one I would love to hear say, Danny, you whipped me. You were so great last night. If I would hear her say that, that would be enough. But Louis can tell you.
Wait, Louis. Really? She's never said that to you after
yeah,
something?
Yeah, we
singing
should.
She has.
Singing.
Huh? Singing, your last gig at the.
Well, the last gig at singing, she came over to me. We were at the Brick House in Wyckoff, New Jersey. We sold the place out. It was new music I was putting out, you know, the things I had mentioned to you about blues and so forth. And at the end of the show, backstage, she looked at me and she said, Danny, you were great. Now, if she knew what that did to me, I expressed to how I felt, but maybe I wasn't able to do it as much as I should have. It was the greatest feeling that I ever had. And also, even my kids, they take me for granted.
Well, that's what kids do.
I know that, but I don't know that. But I know that now.
But that's what kids do, yes.
And to be able to hear my kids say, but now I don't blame them for anything, because acting is acting, and what it is, it is. I sometimes sit back and I resent the fact that, oh, I love this actor. You know, they're talking about someone other than me.
What about me?
What do you mean my favorite actors? What about your father? They could never see me, probably, because when they watch me on the stage, you know what they see? And they see me in film? They say, that's you, Dad.
Right.
Well, I take great pride in saying, yes, that is me, because I try and bring myself to the screen. I try to bring those things that are beneficial to me. Hopefully it would be to audiences watching me beneficial. You know, at the beginning of my career, critics would say, oh man, he's a natural. They were talking about Marlon Brando. I didn't know what I was doing. I couldn't even put together a proper constructed sentence. I didn't know what I was doing. I didn't study. I didn't know what acting was. I just did it. So they said he's a natural. And I accepted that as an insult. I thought natural at that time of my career was an insult to say he's untrained.
Yeah. Yeah.
And I was untrained.
But that just shows what you're sensitive about.
Yeah, that's right.
It's not, it's a reflection of what you're struggling with internally.
Yes.
It's not the truth.
The kid's a therapist too. I knew it. That's what she is besides this wonderful person interviewing people.
You don't realize it, but I actually was.
I know. I know that. I can see it in you. I can see the way you're studying.
Before I started this, I had a therapy practice.
Oh my God. You would be very helpful to me, and you are here.
Well, let's do it separately. We'll go have some therapy sessions, but it's true.
Yeah.
This is what that was just what was up for you,
yeah,
but not the reality of it.
Yeah,
but
yeah.
Isn't that interesting? And it's the same thing where your whole, all of these years, everybody's coming up to you. I mean, Leonardo DiCaprio, first yeah. of all, he's having not just a moment because he's huge and getting better and better and better and better.
Yes.
I mean, really, I could go on and on about how good he is as an actor.
Yeah.
But now with this Quentin Tarantino movie, did you see it?
I have not seen it, but I hope I'm not going against you, but someone who just saw it said it was the worst picture they'd ever seen.
That's fine. It's a split, I think. I think it's a 50-50 split, and I think it depends on your taste for Tarantino.
Yeah.
So, do you like Pulp Fiction?
I didn't see Pulp Fiction, but I'll tell you what I saw last week. It was the most insane picture I've ever seen, Dusk and Dawn. Dusk Till Dawn.
What is that?
It was the craziest movie. People turn into vampires.
Oh, I don't do that.
If you saw it, it must have cost $100 million with the changes. I couldn't believe what I was watching.
I can't do that whole fantasy sci-fi.
Oh,
thing.
It was incredible. It was great. That was the picture. But Pulp Fiction, I saw some of it. I saw Harvey was in it. Keitel. And oh God, no, and the English actor, was it Oldman? It wasn't Oldman, it was Roth.
Oh, Tim Roth.
Yeah,
Roth.
Good actor.
Yes.
And the other people.
John Travolta, yeah, Bruce Willis, Uma Thurman.
Samuel L. Jackson. Who's in every movie. I can't stand him. And no, I can't say he works too much. That's what I mean. Samuel, you work too much. I made you. If it wasn't for Do the Right Thing and you talking about me,
that's
you wouldn't
right.
be as famous.
Do the Right Thing. By the way, your yeah. friend Spike Lee.
Yeah.
So I met him recently. I did a piece with him.
Oh, good.
So I met him. I went out to his offices in Brooklyn. And now I'm doing I was doing a print article for the New York Times.
Wow.
Focused on him. Right? So I'm out there doing that. And I say to him, you've got to come on my podcast. And he said, well, what's it like, you know? And I said, well, it's kind of like Terry Gross, but it's less structured, like very relaxed. We're just going to talk or whatever. And I said, I had Danny Aiello on the show and Michael Imperioli, who, you know, yeah. was in where he worked together with on Summer of Sam. I said, yeah. and he said, send me Aiello and Imperioli. And I said, oh, you mean you want to talk to them? Because yeah. I think they'll vouch for me. He said, I don't need to talk to them. Just send me theirs, you know, because
right.
he wanted to hear what you and I
right,
talked about
right.
because he values
you. Oh, he
you.
Loves me. Tell him, Louis.
Right?
He's
of
crazy.
Course, he's crazy about
no,
you.
No, he loves me. So he calls me up. He calls me sir, which I resent, but he does. And he asked me constantly, we just did. We had he had what they call a 35th anniversary.
30th.
Oh, I know that. Do the right
30th,
thing party.
And I was there.
Yeah, yeah. How, you went there?
He asked me. Okay. I had to go. So there were only he and I. And Rose came. Rosie Perez was there before me.
Okay.
And then I came, and I was the only one there with him. And I have to tell you, I must have seen 200,000 people in the street. I have never seen so many
wow.
people up every street. I couldn't see the street, just heads of people. It was huge. I couldn't believe it, right, Lou? And I did that, and that was it. But they asked me, was it the New York Times? It wasn't the Times, it was...
Vanity Fair, I think.
No, not Vanity, I'm talking about they asked me to do some interviews. They
at
were going
there,
to do
yeah.
clips of mine and use them.
Well, that was the thing at Hollywood. On CNN.
Now, CNN.
Okay.
CNN had the clips they were
yeah.
doing, and I'm sorry I jumped away from you. And they saw shorts on me. They said, we want to use it, we want to pay you money, and so forth. And they were paying an exorbitant amount of money. And then when I saw the clips, I said, you can't use them.
Why?
Because I didn't like them. Because they were cutting them in such a way that it was, to me, it was embarrassing. And I didn't want it to be repeated nationally. It was enough. It was in the movie. Nigga, you know, saying these words over, you black. I said, I didn't want to do that. I know it's acting. They've seen me in the movie. I want them to see the full context
yes,
of the movie.
Definitely.
Not to take a piece out and have me there like a jerk, you know what I mean? Like saying this, black, dad, you this, that. I didn't want that. So I withdrew.
I think that's a smart move.
Well,
I
did.
Say.
I just didn't want to do it.
Yeah.
They're going to show it all. And I don't like CNN anyway. I'm sorry. I'm not a major fan of CNN. I've seen some things that turned me off. In any event.
So, but Spike loves you.
He loves me to death.
I know.
I mean, every time. And I
he
said,
doesn't like me.
Oh, he would.
I'm telling you. I got the vibe.
Yeah, because
he
you're a
like
woman.
Me.
You want to know he wouldn't
is
like?
That
because you're in charge, honey.
What do you mean?
Oh, sure, because what? Strength in a woman, forget about it. He wouldn't buy that. That's not him.
Really?
Oh, I don't think it is. I've never seen that in him. He's a man's kind of man. I don't think he's a woman kind of man.
Well, I feel like he didn't like me from the second that he met me. We sat down for a long interview. At the end, he gave me a tour of all of his memorabilia, which is incredible. You know, yeah. He's got like Sal's pizzeria. He's got the shirt or the pizza box, I think. Yeah. You know, all this stuff from the movie, whatever. But I just felt like, okay, I'll accept that.
He named the street Do the Right Thing. Yeah, it's named the street is now Do the Right Thing Street.
So that's an interesting take.
I think he does like you. He withholds. You might have come to a decision that might be totally not be totally correct.
So now you're the therapist.
Yeah, I don't know, because you're too nice. I don't know why he would not like you unless you're smart, and you are, and it's obvious that you are. And maybe I've never seen him function with a woman. Did you?
That's so
I see him with his wife once in a while. I never seen him. Only his sister. Jade, I see him with her once in a while,
right,
talking.
Right, right. That's so interesting. I'd never thought about
that. Well, look
that.
At him in the movie, the way he was treating Rosie Perez,
sure.
The wife.
Yeah.
And now he wrote the part. Now, you know, he wasn't totally disparaging of the woman, but yet it was like, yeah, I'll see you later type of thing. You know, I think that's him.
That's interesting.
Yeah,
I'm going to chew on that probably on my ride home today.
No, you're too smart. You're beautiful, you're smart, and... He doesn't resent whites, not those that can help him.
Right.
She won't understand
that. Maybe I can't help him.
No, I'll tell you, because Spike is a great marketeer. He's a wonderful guy, and he made a great living with Universal Pictures. I mean, they took care of him. And when, you know, I found that Spike, in so many ways, he's honest, in so many ways, he's a manipulator. I mean, not a manipulator, that's the wrong
but
word.
But he knows what he's doing, maybe.
He knows what he's
a
doing.
Purposeful.
He knows how to get money for his films and so forth, and Universal constantly had given it to him. But you saw, there were interviews that I saw with him where he complained he couldn't get money because of this and that, but he was always able to get money for his movies. Mm-hmm. And now, God knows, he's all over the place. He's doing NBA, he's doing basketball, sneakers, God knows what.
Everything.
Yeah, he really is. He's a once-in-a-lifetime kind of guy.
Totally.
It's incredible.
And he's an artist, too. Oh,
so
he's like an artist,
yes.
And he's a business person.
And he's a damn good director.
Yes.
He knows what and he doesn't take anything. The only guy he wouldn't give anything to, like, how would I say this, that he would be tough with me, never with me. Never would be, not a cross word ever, not a raised voice, but I saw him.
With who?
He'd fight with other people, not John Turturro so much, not even Richard Edson. I'd never really seen him bounce on any actors, but I seen him very tough with the crew. Fire.
Oh, fire just like that?
And then hire the next day.
Really?
He wouldn't do it often, but I've seen
that. Keep talking, I just
have
to press another button. We're cooking. What happens is, after a certain amount of time, for whatever reason, this camera shuts itself off.
That's because the subject is boring.
No, please, anything but we're cooking again. So that's so funny. So he'll hire them back the next day.
But
so he's temperamental,
bad.
Maybe.
Yeah, he is. He's kind, and I had sent a lot of people to him, you know, who had asked me, you know, do you think Spike could help me out? And I sent many people to him, you know. Kids who maybe black kids who had nowhere to go and were looking for things. That kid from Five Napkins.
And does he help?
Yeah, he went there. They would go because he's helpful to anybody who is aggressively wanting to work.
Well, I remember. Oh, it's funny. It just reminded me because I remember one of your stories in your book was that he approached you.
Yeah.
Early on.
Yes.
And then you said, no, this isn't for me.
Exactly.
And then he came back to you again.
Kept coming.
Right, so it wasn't just once a return.
Right.
He kept coming.
Yes.
So in fact, I used you again. I went back to his place when it was time to do a photo shoot for that New York Times piece, right? So this is the second time, it was later. And I say, don't forget, we have to do the podcast. And I said, he said, the podcast. I said, yeah, I'm not going to give up. I'm like Danny Aiello, you and Danny Aiello. You kept going after him, I'm going to keep going after you.
He went after me like crazy.
And he got you.
Invited me to games, came to North Carolina when I was shooting Once Around. He came to North Carolina to get me. It just kept doing. I thought it was too much of a...
But see, even after this, I can't believe that you didn't let it sink into your confidence, like into your psyche.
Phony confidence by me. Let me tell you, we're walking up the Golden Globe and the Academy Awards. He's sitting in the audience and so am I. I'm up for Best Supporting Act. He's up for screenplay. I walk up the aisle and the most confidence thing I ever said to him, remember, I brought you to the dance. That's what I said.
He must have loved that.
Oh, he did.
I bet he loved it.
Yes. But that was the most courageous thing I had ever said.
That's
and
beautiful.
He says things like this to me. We made history.
You did.
That's what he says to me.
Yeah.
He said, Danny, I said, you know something? When I see advertising on this and the picture when they show it in television, I never hear them say Danny Aiello was nominated for an Academy Award. I mean, that's complimentary to you. Oh, don't worry about that. He said, listen, Danny, Glory. He said, Denzel Washington won for Glory. Does anyone talk about Glory today?
Right,
that's what he said to me.
Nobody ever talks
Everybody
about Glory.
Everybody talks because the picture was.
Yeah, it really
Matthew
means something.
Broderick, who I love with a mustache, they playing a general. Are you serious? He looks 17 years old.
He still looks 17.
I know, and I love him, and I love him. But, and he said, we made history. Do you I would see quotes that he would send to me. You would flip.
Oh,
the
really?
The things
that
he says about what we did, it isn't him. When talking to me, he's talking about him and I. And of course, Ruby Dee, and of course, Ozzie Davis, who I loved. I loved Ozzie. Ozzie comes to me one day. We didn't have, it was not a very expensive picture, Do the Right Thing. So we couldn't afford vans and things of that nature. I got paid well in it, but not as well as I usually do, but we had no place to stay. We stayed in a school. Now, when we walked through those streets in Bed-Stuy, there were vials on the floor, there were needles on the ground. He even told us, don't watch where you step. You may step on a needle and so forth. Two of my sons were in the movie with me. Now, Danny was the stunt coordinator. He's the boy that died of pancreatic cancer, 2010. And Rick, my son who played the police officer who killed Radio Raheem, he strangled him. He's terrified of that, even to this day. He said he hates to go into neighborhoods. They look at him, they want to kill him.
Oh, so they remember.
I said,
and even if they don't know why, they associate.
That's right.
Yeah.
And he says they bring it up to him. Sometimes he feels real bad about that. But I'll never forget what Ozzie Davis said to me. He said, I love your sons. I love them. He said, they are so good. This is Ozzie Davis, a wonderful actor and a wonderful human being. And he blew me away. And
so that was meaningful
and
to you.
Let me tell you the one thing. Some of my friends were not enamored by Spike Lee. They saw his, because he was doing his thing, you know. And let me tell you something. Danny Aiello, the third, dies. We're in the funeral home, Campbell Funeral Home on Columbus Avenue. The place was packed. A lot of actors came for him, not for me, for him, because they loved him. And people that he taught how to stunt, people that he stunt people around, it was jammed with people. I'm sitting down front with my family by myself, all the way down front, not even noticing who was there. Later, I found out that a person in the back kept walking down as far as I was. I was on the aisle in the front, stopped and went back, came down again, stopped and went back, third time, comes down, kneels next to me, and he says, can I say something? Spike Lee. He wants to do a eulogy for Danny. He gets up and does it. Talks about Ricky, talks about me, and he talks about my son, and what it was to have the three of us together on the set. Louis was not enamored, our buddy, with Spike until he himself saw this. Blew everybody away. It was so meaningful. He didn't have, this is a joint where he would, this is a place where he probably would not feel comfortable.
Yeah.
He's there as a director and he walks down an aisle without anyone being with him, all by himself in the place and does that.
Yeah.
So I loved him. I loved him before that, but this was
really meaningful. Wow. Know. But that's, I see you're there. He's like, there's a dichotomy going on that it's hard to write. I'm gonna turn it to, I don't want to put you in a bad mood, but Scorsese, of course, we talked about last time.
Yeah, I don't like him.
You don't like him?
No, he's a little punk.
So he didn't put you in The Irishman?
Great actor. No, he wouldn't put me in anything.
I know,
but let me give you a story.
I thought it was going to be time.
Since we spoke the last time, let me give you some new development.
Oh, please.
Right, Lou? We did a movie called, Louis?
Brooklyn Lobster.
Brooklyn Lobster, which I did, but we didn't talk about when we were in the thing.
No,
okay?
I don't remember.
Now, you know that Marty has not put me in anything. When I was at the Academy Award, I was representing one of his movies. Because I was nominated the following year, they gave me a movie to represent.
And oh, the movie, you read that? You mean you
read
the...
Yeah, to introduce.
Right.
Yeah. Goodfellas. Okay, and up on the stage for millions of people, I said, I am the only Italian-American in this country that's not in this movie. I didn't cut him on, you know, I just said, I'm not in it, okay? And every single time I volunteered to do things for one of his movies, for nothing, just to be in the movie. Now keep in mind, when I did that, I was hot. I was all over the place, Knockout, Marquee, all over. I had about three movies, so I'm hot. So there's, you know, I'm hot.
Yeah.
So, but never would he call me. And we would tell him that we're available, and he would never call us to come in. So I began to think. I have my reasons why.
Well, I know what your reasons why are, I think, right? Because there's the drug issue.
Yeah. I think that could have been it, and but I'm not saying he does, but I know that there are some sets you go on that people are straight, are thought of as problems if people are doing things. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
People are doing drugs.
Right, they're like a buzzkill.
You don't want to strike.
Yeah.
You don't want a straight guy. And I'm a guy that was outwardly against drugs. Now, you notice in my book, I never said that. I said that maybe he thought I was a bad actor. Maybe, you know, maybe I stopped
it. Right, you never said that. But you had told me that when we were talking.
Yes, I never said that.
That's why
I didn't want to put it in the book because I don't know that. I thought that. I said, what other reason could it be? What?
Yeah.
So I was thinking, throwing things around. Now, we shoot to Brooklyn Lobster, okay? I go to my movie. I'm the star of the movie. It was a small movie it's a wonderful movie. Robert Ebert loved it, raved about it. I think it cost about $50 to make. This kid, Kevin Jordan, directed it and written it. He had a little place out in Long Island called Lobster Farm. It was a lobster farm,
okay.
Jordan Lobster Farm. So I'm doing the movie, it's based on a true story. Now, I go to see the movie, okay? I'm sitting in the theater. The movie comes on, and it says, Marty Scorsese presents Danny Aiello in Brooklyn Lobster.
Wait, what? What is that about?
Kevin Jordan was an ex-NYU student working under Marty Scorsese, so my feeling is that he was doing Kevin a favor to put his name. He was never a producer. He was never on the set. He saw the footage. The footage constantly was going to.
Wow.
That's when I began to think. I'm saying, well, maybe it wasn't that I was a bad actor in his eyes. If I was, why in every frame of the movie that I happen to be in would he put his name associated with mine?
Right, but here's the thing, right? If he wasn't involved, he would have had to see the movie and said, I'll put my name on this.
They sent him, yeah.
Right, he wouldn't
Kevin
do it if
sent
it wasn't
him,
good.
No. So he had to make a justification. Well, Danny's terrific in the movie.
Stop, this is impossible. Nobody would ever think that you're a bad actor. That's not a possibility, it never was.
Yeah.
That could have never been the reason.
Yeah, well, but you see, being the person that I am.
I know.
I had to take that trick. I had to say, well, maybe that's the reason. Maybe he just hated me as an actor. And then I would see some of the actors he had in some of his movies and they weren't that spectacular. The stars were. The stars, always Bobby, you know, always great. Harvey, always great. And remember something, as a director, to have those kind of actors in your hands when you're starting as a director is not too bad.
Right.
You're not in bad shape.
Right, and then you get to hold on to them.
That's right.
Film after film.
And they all grew together.
So did he ever hear any like whisperings of the fact that you think... How do you know?
Well, I know because he steps across the street if he sees me walking down. The Academy Awards, he's coming up the stairs. He saw me going down. He went the other way.
Really? So yeah. Why?
Should I tell him what Brian Hamill said? I yelled at him once.
Yeah, what happened?
I think it was Sardi's. I'm not sure. Brian Hamill said it wasn't Sardi's. Brian Hamill's one of the great still photographers. You know his brother. Dennis Hamill, he's a writer. Pete Hamill, great Pete Hamill.
Oh, yeah.
Those are his brothers. Okay. And they're all very talented people.
So they're all talented.
And Brian said, Danny, what are you kidding? Don't you remember what you did? I said, what? You came in the restaurant, you started out beat the... You started,
oh, that's right. I forgot. What did you do?
Yeah, I started... He said, I don't remember that incident the way Brian does, but Brian never lies. And he has a great memory.
So that's why he avoids you.
He said, Danny, you started yelling. I'm working with him. I'm doing the still photography on the movie, and you're screaming at him at a distance, not right there.
So who was sitting
with him? They said, Brian told me Joey Pesci was there, and who I'm not a major fan of, you know.
Joe Pesci. So since then, though, there's been no interaction with Scorsese.
We have none.
That's it.
None.
It's done.
And that's why, obviously, I could have been in The Irish. There's no question. You know, in this, I'm playing. Have you ever been in love, me girl?
Wait, so
or
listen.
Have you felt the pain? I've never. What is it, Louis?
I'd sooner be in jail
myself to be in love again. The girl I love is beautiful. I'll have you all to know. And I met her in the garden in the.
Pratis.
In the Pratis, where the Pratis were. Pratis in Irish is potatoes.
Oh, okay.
She was the kind of creature, boys, that nature didn't tend to walk right through the world, me boys, without the Grecian bend. Nor did she wear the chignon, I'll have you all to know. And I met her in the garden where the pretties grow. I'm playing an Italian Irishman. I don't speak with an accent in the movie, but the father, this is a true story.
Okay.
Her father used to get up and sing Irish songs because he was half Italian, half Irish. But his father was a man that used to sing, and my father, the character's father, used to sing up until the age I was 7, right? And I tried to mimic him. So what I do is when I get up at a party we have or something, I sing Irish songs
because
with a bad Irish accent.
Oh, because all your songs, I wasn't used to hearing you singing the Irish song.
No, because that's not the way I sing.
Right.
I sing Danny Boy in the movie, too.
All right, let's talk about the film.
Yeah.
So here we are in or on Long Island because you're filming this movie.
One moment.
So, and it may or may not be out around like the holidays or something this year, right?
Yeah,
possibly, or maybe early 2020 or something like that.
Right.
So you've been filming for a couple of weeks. So tell me a little bit about how that whole process is for you. So you like to be home doing nothing.
Yeah.
And here you are at a hotel.
Yes.
In Long Island.
Yeah.
For like weeks of filming.
I was approached by this woman who read my book and said, I've been pursuing you for some time. When I read my book, I realized how much you were like my father. So we agreed, based on just that explanation that she had given me, to meet her in New York City, not in an office anywhere, not in an official capacity, just in 5 Napkins on 45th Street and 9th Avenue. That's where Louis and I hang out.
I know that
place. She came in.
Mm-hmm.
Her name is Deirdre O'Connor. She sat there and we talked and I just adored the person. She was just a nice, nice person. She gives me the script. I take it home and read it. And I call Louis. I said, Louis, this is the best script I've read in 20 years. I have to do this script. There's no money, Danny. I don't give a hell how much money. Well, it's pennies, you know. I don't care. I have to do this script. Now, the truth is I'm worried about it. Do I want to dedicate myself to 4 solid weeks? I got the biggest role. I'm in almost every scene. If you can swallow that, you know, it's all right. To think that I'm in every scene is enough to drive people away.
That's
but I want to tell you that the script is such family, funny, sad. Here's a man who feels self-assured about singing. a person asks him to be in a talent show. Because I saw you at the karaoke. Joe, you were terrific. Well, you know, some people say I'm pretty good. Oh no, I would love you to appear in my show. I said, well, you know, my daughters keep me pretty busy. I don't think so. But then I thought for a minute, he gives me a flyer and I look and I said, but I do want to do your show. I tell everyone I'm going to be Saturday, I'm doing the talent show. So everyone comes. I get on the stage, the song I was just singing you, which I sing early, completely in a movie. I start singing, I tell a story and I said, this is a song that I sang to my wife over 60 years ago. And I promise you, you'll love what this girl did.
Okay, so what is it called?
It's called One Moment.
One Moment. Everyone's gonna love it. They're gonna love you in it. You're still not gonna feel like you did a good job,
no,
even
well,
though you already hit it out.
I know I'm doing a good job, but she tells me enough, doesn't she, Louie? But the one moment, it isn't, I don't want to make so much out of it because I say the line.
Yeah.
They're talking about beautiful times in their life. And I said to him, what do you think, Dad? I said, one moment would never tell a story. I said, people feel that way. I said, but if you're stuck on the past being good, you'll miss how good it is now, something
sure.
like that.
That makes perfect sense,
yeah.
And it's true.
Yeah, yeah, it's a beautiful film.
All right, so we're gonna see that. Everybody's gonna see it when it comes out.
Yeah, I hope so.
And we're gonna also listen to your music.
Yeah.
But I have a question for you also. Something you just said, it reminded me of something in your book again. So I'm reading your book, and it's like, you've been doing a million things, like since the beginning,
yeah.
A million different steps to get to acting even, period. So we could spend all day, we're not going to. But it seems to me like things kept happening for you, like doors kept opening. Everybody liked you. Everybody said, oh, I have a thing for you here, or do you want to help me out with this project? And it just kept happening. Like,
yeah.
It doesn't sound like you ever had to fight for anything.
No, it came.
Right?
I never auditioned.
I do not think that's
I stopped auditioning my second year. I completely stopped, and I didn't stop because I thought I was special. I thought that I couldn't, auditioning, I could not get anything. I believe that, for instance, if you're an actress, and I've seen some of your work, we're saying, you come in, I'm directing you. I would hire you on the basis of one thing. The relationship that I have and what the exchange of dialogue that we both had, I could tell that you would be excellent in the part that I want you for.
Mm-hmm.
You follow what I'm saying?
Yeah, sure.
Now, when you go in there and when you're looking at someone, they generally put you through terrible situations. Not that that's their intent, but they don't even know what their character should or would be. The writer has an idea. Even a writer sometimes doesn't know who that character is. They bring actors in and they have actors read for these roles and they photo them. You understand?
Yeah.
What an actor does is they come into a reading for a part, actor, actress, and the director's sitting there, often the writer. They have ideas of who their characters are. They've developed, I mean, the writer has developed the character, and the interpretation of that character is done then by a director. But they're never finished. Now, they're always looking for actors to come in and read. And they'll see at the very moment a person physically comes in is not right, but they sometimes allow the person to read. And in that reading, that person who's not getting the part may give a reading that will determine who that character is, who that director wants that character to be, and who that writer wants. They come up with ideas and they'll say, he's not getting the role, but the way he played that character, that's who it is. So many of the directors and writers get all their ideas from the actors. So not only is the actor serving as a person trying to get the job, but also giving them information as to who this character is.
Right, so ideas,
You follow me?
Yeah, yeah, yeah. So they're giving, even if they don't land the job, they're
absolutely.
Still giving them this information
absolutely.
To help form the movie.
When I did my series, Della Ventura, I was the person who made the decisions, okay, on who the characters were. I was working every day, so I didn't have time. So in my camper, they would give me the auditions. And right from the auditions, I would look at what the people were doing, and I would get tremendous ideas from these actors.
That's so
interesting. So we used those actors. Which, you know, the idea is to give them the part if they're good enough, we want to. But often there's only one person that's going to get the part, and they may read 50 people, and they'll get ideas about it.
Well, that's how the creative process is, right? Yeah. You get ideas from all over,
absolutely.
When they're unexpected also, but that's how it works.
But a director goes in after seeing 50 people do that role and has a great idea of who this character is.
That's so interesting.
They don't know, they're just reading words, and you know what I mean? And then later when actors come in and perform it, they're learning who the hell they are.
All right, Moonstruck, when you think back to it, what do you think of? Like, is there a little something that happened on set?
Norman Jewison and I loved. Yeah, there was something in the set that happened. I don't know if I should tell you.
Of course you should tell me.
I'm not going to tell you who the person is that did it. There was someone that was passing wind.
I think I've heard this.
And we all sit, and we all thought it was the old guy. It happened to be one of the actresses. And how did I find out? I found out because at the time I was doing a play on Broadway, and there were three nuns. They were playing three nuns in the show. And I was telling them the story, and they said, "We know who it is." And I said, and they named it. They said, "We called her the biggest fart layer in the, when we walked."
But it wasn't Cher, for the record.
No, definitely not Cher. Definitely not.
What about?
We all thought it was Louis Gus. Louis Gus is the uncle who said, "The moon," not the old man, the next to the old man. We thought it was him because he surprisingly, he would leave. We would be in a whole bunch of us together, and suddenly one person would leave, and then, whoa! And we'd look at each other and say, and it happened every time, because Norman Jewison is a stage director. He's a great director, and I love him so much. He would set a stage, so we rehearsed before we actually did it. Most pictures you don't rehearse. Some directors like to rehearse, some want it cold.
Oh,
they want you to come
fresh.
In and, you know, but they don't want you rehearsed and practiced. But he set up things so you knew when you were on the set where you were going, exactly what you were going to do. So we'd have these sets and the actors would all be in it, and then one person would leave. Sometimes we didn't know who it was. We tried to figure who was the person that left. And this person would leave it and then go, and we were left with the stink.
And that's what sticks out to you.
This person happened to be
later.
A vegetarian who did a lot of passing of wind, you know.
So what about, was there an incident that you haven't told the story to already on The Godfather Part 2? I know that everybody asks you this question, I'm sure of it, and you have an answer that you tell everybody.
Yeah.
I don't want that answer.
No.
I want you to react to The Godfather Part 2 in hindsight,
well,
like anything,
yeah,
not
well,
the same answer.
Yeah, well, my part, it was a larger part than what it turned out to be. There was a sit down in an Italian restaurant or a bar in New York City with Carmine Caridi, may he rest in peace, who just passed away 2 weeks ago. He was my brother, one of the Rosado brothers, big guy. And his name was Carmine Caridi. This particular thing, Piantangeli, was played by Michael Gazzo. And in a scene, I had to strangle him. And I had to come from behind the bar, and he was set up by my brother Carmine, who was sitting at the bar with him. He says, "I don't understand this $50, you give me something like that." He says, "Oh no, it's no problem." I come up behind him, I get a garrote and I put it around his neck, and I drag him into the phone booth, and I'm trying to kill him, and in walks a cop, and he said, "What's going on here?" And he walks to the back, and I run out without killing him. And I yell at the bartender, "You open your effing mouth, I'll kill you." And I run out, we have the gun battle out in the street. Rehearsing that particular scene, I had no line. There was no line that I had. All I had to do was come from the back, garrote him, and drag him out. He said, "Let's rehearse," Francis Coppola says. So we're rehearsing the scene. And as I come around, I throw the garrote over his head to his neck. And I said, "Michael Corleone says hello." And he says, "Cut." He said, "What did you say?" And I was so beside myself because this is a big director. It's one of the first things I'm doing. And I said, I think I said, "Michael Corleone says hello." He says, "Good, keep it in."
Brilliant.
Now, I know I might have told you that because it's all over.
Yes.
the internet.
It's a great story, though.
But keep in mind, I had no idea why I said it. I knew that in the picture, we don't know who hired us. We're talked about, but there was no...
Oh, so it's not that obvious, not that clear.
That's right.
Right, gotcha.
And no one thought, what did that mean? People would ask, what does that mean? They asked me, I have no idea. I didn't know who was sending me there. I mean, my part didn't tell me who was sending me there. I didn't know who I was working with. There were statements made by, he sent them. You know, this guy sent them. The guy from Miami sent them. No one really knew. I didn't know. I just said the line to cover. I said, how can I do this without saying something? And I said, Michael Corleone. So I said, I blamed it on Michael. But it really wasn't Michael who had it done, whatever.
Who was it then who had it done? I can't remember. Who was it?
Well, the Jewish guy.
It was Hyman Roth?
Yeah, Hyman Roth. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Oh, so but he still let it stay in?
Yeah, yeah.
That is interesting.
But I had no, I wasn't smart enough to know what, I just said words.
So it just came out, you were acting, you were in whatever zone you get into when you know who you are because you're someone else.
Was I trying to blame Michael Corleone? You know what I mean? I said Michael Corleone said hello.
Yeah.
But even if I killed him, he wouldn't know anyway what I said. Right. You know what I mean? He's dead.
Yeah.
So the whole thing was very confusing. When you see it again, you say, what the hell does that mean?
And I will, because if it's ever on TV, I will keep watching.
And
like
also,
if I'm going through it.
And also, who I never met Brando, and I wanted to meet Brando. And this is a story I never told you, it's briefly. I was doing Della Ventura, and I was offered The Last Don, which made a lot of money. And you know, the big Les Moonves gave me these jobs. I mean, he made me so much money.
Les Moonves?
I loved him.
Really?
I know he went through this damaging stuff recently. He said, I'd love you to do this. And he offered me three things. Picture chart, play a priest, play a fireman, or play a private detective, and I'll have the things written for you. And I ended up doing the detective, which was Della Ventura. So now we're at Carnegie Hall with all the buyers of television, and I'm being introduced as doing The Last Don, and I had just done Della Ventura. So just before going out on the stage, I'm handing an envelope, okay? And I open it up, it says, to be hand-delivered to Danny Aiello. I open the envelope, and it says, Dear Danny, and it's from Brando. And he says to me, I wish I was as exquisite as you were in The Last Don. Now, keep in mind, I thought The Last Don sucked. I thought the makeup was terrible. I loved myself as the old man in The Last Don. I didn't particularly like it. But it won Emmys. It won everything, you know.
Yeah,
and
it,
won
it was respected.
It was the most watched whatever. And he wrote this, and I have the letter framed. And then he goes on to say, you did so much for civil rights. Because he was into that. I don't know what the hell I did for civil rights.
What did you do? What did he mean?
He was adding
do
the
right
thing.
Do the right thing, he meant. Oh my God, so just like Spike Lee said, what you did.
He said The Last Don, and he said, and what he said about you did so much for civil rights.
He meant do the right thing? That's so interesting.
Yeah. He meant do the right thing.
And little did you know that Brando was watching you this whole
I had no idea.
Time.
One of the greats.
That's incredible.
Never met him.
That's
never
too bad that you never met him. But you know what? Your interactions are priceless. You didn't need to meet him.
Yeah.
What you got from him,
yeah.
You didn't even need to.
I'm going
to
send you a copy of the letter so you can see it.
Do that. I would love to.
Yeah, I'll do it, right, Louis? Yeah, I got to show it to him.
I want to see. That's amazing.
Make sure Louis has everything on you so I can get in touch with you.
Okay.
Okay. Who does she look like? Does she look like the kid who traveled me all over the country? You don't see that in the face? No.
First of all, she's blonde.
Not the blonde. The brunette. Who went to Italy with me and everything.
I don't know that one.
Talking about you, love you talking.
Debbie.
Not Debbie Zola. She's my makeup artist.
No, but the only one I know that traveled with you is the blonde. What's her name?
She's not a blonde, Louis. She's brown hair. You saw her as a blonde?
Yeah.
It looks just like her.
Next time,
Lynn Rice.
Lynn Rice is blonde.
She's a brunette.
And maybe she's a natural brunette who dyes her
hair. No, she's a natural brunette.
You may have, when she knew you, it was true.
Yeah, but she looks, got her eyes, she took care of me.
Well, next time you go to Italy, I'm coming with you,
not her. Let me tell you this. The trouble, my son Danny, may rest in peace.
Yeah.
I needed someone to take care of me when I was on the road. All the things that I had to do, I didn't know what was happening.
Jose Ferrer directed.
That's major Jose Ferrer. He's major, right? He was major.
Yeah, he's a great guy. He was wonderful with me. And I met his ex-wife, Rosemary Clooney, who took me to California.
Wait, Rosemary Clooney was his ex-wife?
Yeah, what was it?
And she's George Clooney's aunt, or she was.
Yeah, that's right.
Ah, that's so interesting.
Yeah, and Rosemary, I didn't know Rosemary, but I loved the way she sung. And she asked me to sing. I didn't even, well, she saw me in a movie or something sing, and she said, and I sang at the Agnes, what is it, the Agnes Woolley Hall or something, where they had the Academy Awards. And I sung two Irving Berlin songs, Always, and Something with the Sun. I forget. I'll be loving you always. And I'm on the plane flying, and who am I sitting next to? Irving Berlin's daughter. And when I said, I have to sing this song, she said, that was my, Blue Skies. She said, my father's favorite song was Always.
Really?
That's what his
You have so many of these moments. So many. It's really incredible.
Yeah.
I think I really, you blow me away. I know it doesn't matter because I'm not Sandy telling you that, or
no,
your kids
but,
telling you that.
Oh, that's very nice that you held on to
but
it means a lot to me.
But really.
You say it. Louie, don't I get excited when people say it, right? I just don't know how to react to it.
I know, I guess.
That's it.
But also a lot of people, like a lot of famous people, don't like their fans almost, I think. Maybe I won't say a lot, but I think there are plenty of people who kind of fans.
I see that all the time.
Right?
I've seen it with my friends, though. And I hate their behavior.
Yeah.
I've seen friends, I'm not going to mention their names, sitting at a table, a person walks over. You have to understand me. I could be sitting there eating. If a person comes to me, what do, Louie?
You always stop and give them attention.
I cannot ignore that.
Yeah, yeah.
I cannot do it because I know I'm a public figure and I'm up there. And listen, any actor who tells you, I don't want that, they're full of shit. Excuse my language. The people go into that because they want that. It's just that it gets old to some of the people and they want to. They don't want it. They don't want it later.
You know what?
Go ahead.
Your buddy Samuel L. Jackson was on 60 Minutes maybe 6 months ago, and he said something just like that.
Is that
he
right?
said, when an actor tells you, you know, they don't want this attention, this is a look at me profession.
Yes.
I don't buy it.
I feel the same
This
way.
Is not verbatim, but that's the kind of thing
I feel
he said.
And I could name friends of mine who got up. You know who I'm not going to mention their names. I mean, how could you do that? I seen a wheelchair. I saw a kid in a wheelchair refuse because the kid came to me first in the wheelchair. And the other actor who was with me in the film said, I don't want to. Now, why?
Yeah, yeah.
Why
I
would?
Don't know.
And then I saw, I'm eating. Can you see I'm eating? And these guys, I'm saying, how could you do that? What? How can you do that?
And Danny got to smack him in the film.
I smacked the shit out of him.
But listen, seriously, though, people are different. Not everybody's the same. Not everybody has the same heart. Not everybody feels for other people the same way.
Yeah.
People come in all shapes
You're
and sizes,
right.
stripes,
and
whatever.
That's the way I should be thinking because it is. No one is really the same as the other.
Right, and you are who you are, and it's a beautiful thing. And everybody's lucky. Whoever's there coming up to you, whoever's watching you, they're lucky.
Thanks, kid.
I'm going to ask you one more question. Let me think of a good... I don't know. I'm trying to think of it on the spot.
All
what do you think a good closing question is for you
a
for
what,
this?
Babe?
A good closing question. What do you think?
I'm still going, babe.
How about... Yeah?
We have a play coming up that we'll be doing on Broadway. It's called Pop. It's written by Michael Christopher. He won the Pulitzer Prize for Shadowbox. And it's one of the great scripts that I've read, and it's already been optioned by my producer, Rose.
We have a great producer, too.
Yeah, she's won 5 Tonys. Her name is Rose Coyola. Mm-hmm. Are you familiar with that
yes.
name?
Yes, and yeah.
She's the greatest.
Louie and I were talking about it before. It sounds good. So that's when is that coming to Broadway?
Well, we don't know now, because I'm with this, and the other thing is my life story, which is somebody else. We're making a movie.
Wait, you are?
Oh, yeah. That's in the work, and we already have the script.
Oh.
And there's no problem with financing.
So that's going right now.
I'm sorry?
That's in the works right now.
That's in the works right now, yeah. Because
all right, keep me
posted. It's going to be too old to do it. But keep in mind, I'm not starring in everything. I am in 50% of the film as me, with me now, the things I'm doing. But then you'll see me as 20,
sure.
35, 50. You'll see three different guys playing. Well, actually three with the little boy.
Right, with the little boy.
The little boy playing me.
Well, it's like a Bronx Tale.
Yeah.
Yeah. You see him as a little kid, or even Goodfellas had different ages.
You'll see, it's terrific.
I know. Why did I say that?
What?
Cut.
A Bronx Tale is a bad analogy.
A Bronx Tale is a bad analogy?
No, it's good.
Is that one okay? But Goodfellas. Oh, wait. Bronx Tale is Chaz Palminteri.
No, that's yeah, whatever.
That has nothing to do with Scorsese. Is there bad blood there?
I like.
No, but it's not going to be the same. His story is real. It's
my story is real.
Of course. Yeah. But so is a Bronx Tale.
No, it isn't.
What do you mean?
All bullshit.
Excuse me.
Three guys wrote that Bronx Tale.
Wait.
Mike Starr,
what?
Ranzulli, and Chaz. Three guys. They had the big fallout. They haven't spoken. They're two actors, the other guy. One guy, Ranzulli, is one of the writers from The Sopranos, one of the head writers. And Mike Starr was an actor who looked something like me. And Chaz Palminteri, they had a fallout. Two-thirds of them left. He had the script. I'm talking about
Chaz.
Chaz. Uh-huh. It went to Bobby. Bobby got enamored by it. It wasn't true. There was a lot of BS involved in it, but you know, there were three guys writing it.
Wait, the story I heard from Chaz himself is that he wrote it as a one-man play, starred in it, did the whole thing himself. Are you telling me that's totally bogus?
Three guys.
So how do you know this?
I know the guys.
What was the movie? No.
Yeah, Bronx Tale was a movie first.
No. I'm not talking about the Broadway play. Yeah, he says that he couldn't get work, and so he started writing for himself. So he started writing this one-man play to act in himself, a small thing.
Three guys. Wrote.
And then that he kept kind of putting it down, like getting it better and better and better, like getting the waste out and making it a play that he performed in L.A., like, we're talking years and years ago.
It's true, he did do one man, but it was based on the movie, A Bronx Tale.
He said he did it before.
We don't know that. He might have done it before, and we didn't know. We thought he did it only after the play, after the picture.
Yeah.
But here's all I
okay,
ask
okay, okay,
you.
Okay,
here's
yeah.
the only thing I would ask you is, we were told these things way when it was happening. Mike Starr knew me. And Ranzulli knew me, because I got Ranzulli a job. He stopped me on the street and he said, "Hi, Danny Aiello, Mike." So I called up my agent. He told me he was an actor, the kid. Uh-huh. Richard Astor was my agent. I said, "Richard, there's a wonderful actor." Anyway, I didn't even know the kid. Whatever. So Richard started to handle him. The kid gets in the Woody Allen movie with me. He's one of the little gangsters who beats me up in the car or something, beats Woody up in the car. Ask anyone if they know Ranzulli. Take this down, the name down.
Okay.
Ranzulli. And Mike Starr, because that's the source who told me. So whether it was true or not, it would start there. They will tell you everything.
So
everything that you want to know.
That's crazy.
He's an actor, Mike Starr.
So do they feel like they were screwed by him?
Oh, they don't talk to him. I haven't spoken to him in 25 years.
Oh, this, you're blowing my mind right now.
I
can't
believe
it.
To you, honey.
No, it's...
Now, let's say this. Maybe Chaz is telling a total truth. Maybe he is. I am telling you what Ranzulli and Mike Starr told me. Talk to him. They were great. They were writing together. That's what they said.
Wow.
Everyone knew it. Everyone around the neighborhood knew it, all the actors. Just see if you can touch with them and say, "I was wondering," so forth and so on. Do a little investigative work.
Yeah, I can do that. I mean, I wouldn't normally do that, but
but kill Chaz with it, because
so
Chaz came up with the movie's there. The right. evidence, I mean, he
right,
did
he
his
job. Because
he
says that happened to him. He says that he was Calogero.
Yeah.
That's what he said.
Yeah.
Okay, that's interesting.
So the point is, he was a success at what he did.
Yeah.
The movie sold. He's going around. It was on Broadway. The strange thing is, not one Tony was given to that play. I mean, it sounds crazy. How could they not give a Tony nomination to the play, to someone in it?
Well, maybe, I don't know. Did you see it?
No.
Didn't see it.
No, I didn't see it either.
No,
I didn't either.
Okay, I'm going to ask you this question.
Go ahead.
What's your biggest secret that you have never told anyone?
I'm such an open book. I wouldn't call it a secret, but I never cursed in front of my mother. Is that a secret
that's
to be
a
told?
Nice, that's a really nice
I
thing.
I never used
and an appropriate thing.
One thing came out once. I just got out of the army, and the family sitting around the table. I'm not going to say
I think
the
it's
word.
In the book, yeah.
Huh?
I think so too. That story I thought was in
I wrote that, but that's yeah. I mm-hmm, cut 30,000 mm-hmm. words before
He's
you.
He's
know.
The best editor, best book editor.
I can imagine. Yeah. Well, I can't imagine what it's like to write a book, by the way. Like, I know you had help with it, I'm sure, but.
No.
You didn't have any help with it?
I wrote everything.
Wait, there's somebody's name on here, though.
No, his name is Gil Revell. And Danny Aiello wrote everything. He put the commas in
period. Wait, I don't see his name on it now, but I thought I saw
it
before.
It's there. It's
where is it? I thought it was like right there.
I made sure it was there.
Yeah, that's why, because I saw another name, I figured.
No, there's another name.
Yeah, here it is, real big.
Gil Revell.
But are you saying?
Periods and commas.
Oh, really?
Constructive sentence. Everything, when he would use words like but, he would put in, I said, Gil, this guy was so wonderful. Am I right, Louis? I love Gil. The sad thing I had, I should have had him to stay with the script.
Well, Carol, I know for a fact because he used to write a story.
Yeah.
I write, you know how I write it?
A moment, then, as in one moment.
You know what my secretary was?
What?
Siri.
Yeah.
Oh, you just told it to Siri?
I had my dog in my arm. I wrote every single word. 90,000.
So you didn't type them out, you told
no,
Siri.
No, I do it for, I talk and
you talk
I,
it. You have to correct it.
I type it in.
And he'd send it to
that's
me.
Like the worst though, everything. That's tedious.
Yes.
But story by story, so one moment at a time right there.
One moment at a time.
He would send it to me.
Everything.
Then I put it into a Word file.
Yeah.
And then once we, I would give a copy
we give
to
it all
Gil,
to him.
And I'd give a copy to Danny so that
we gotcha.
I didn't tell
I gotcha.
Gil anything.
I gotcha.
I didn't tell Gil anything.
Oh, so you just
I wrote
to,
everything
I
and then sent it to him right. and made certain right. and it were constructed, right?
Look, we also sat around his kitchen table, uh-huh. Danny's table, and designed how it was going to play. Danny yeah. would design it and say, let's start when I'm a kid and go
I over. Did it at my kitchen table with my little Maltese in my arm. Every word I wrote was her
that's
in my
sweet.
Arm.
But that's still, even like that, it just seems like a big ordeal.
That's my
today.
Secret, all right? That I have no baby. Oh, I love Gil. He will tell you. He yeah. will tell you. Danny wrote every yeah. word in this book. He would sometimes put a word in and it stuck out like a thing.
Right, it's like, I don't use
like
that, right. Right. Gil. You know whose book I read who didn't say, I didn't know her personally, but I knew that she had like nothing to do with it. It's Sophia Loren.
Right.
Yeah,
because it just doesn't sound.
You know, but you know.
I don't
read,
know her, but I know when I read. Yeah, for sure. You know. And I know you.
There's one thing I used of his, right, Louis?
What?
That I loved. The introduction of the story when it was like these people lived in boulevards.
Oh, right.
That I said, I love that expression.
In boulevards.
Do you know what I'm talking about?
I'm
a street
so
guy.
So you're talking about when you grew up in New York?
So
you're talking about when you grew up in New York? Yeah.
But just the idea that Danny was street, not boulevard.
Right, not boulevard, yeah. I get it.
You know.
All right, I'm going to ask you one more question because I want a better ending than the secret that you don't have.
All right.
If there was one thing that you could change about your life, just one small thing and everything else would stay the same, what would you change?
I'd have a father. I didn't have a father. I didn't miss him at the time because I thought everyone was that way. But he was a wanderer, you know. He had children with other women and forth. The strange thing about that is we loved him because my mother never badmouthed him. My mother loved him from the day she died. And he was out of the house. Well, think how long. I never knew him living in the house. So that was it. Yeah, I would to have a father. Louis talks about his father all the time, and I can't, you know.
All right, I'm going to circle this together for a minute for you. So I feel like that could be part of the reason why you can't accept and feel good about all of your successes.
Yeah,
fully.
That could be a good reason, absolutely.
Because that's one validation that you didn't get.
Yeah, and also I was an outstanding ball player. everything that I did, even I was a hustler, pool hustler before becoming an actor, everything that I did, for some reason, something important happened. I was a great athlete. When I went into the service kept me as a ball player. I played baseball in Germany for 28 months instead of going to Korea. I was supposed to go to Korea. They sent me to Germany instead. I entertained troops playing baseball, okay? My father never saw me play baseball, never complimented me, never said this, never said. I didn't miss it. Don't get me wrong. I'm only saying this now. I didn't miss it then. I didn't know.
And wait, here's the other tie-in we figured out the other day. Bud Friedman hires him to work at the Improv.
Yeah.
Because he was a banger.
That's right. That's right. I remember that from the book.
So, and because of that, he runs into Lou LaRusso, who writes the first play he does on Broadway.
Yeah.
But also, they're having auditions for
baseball.
His first movie was a baseball movie, and then
Bang
he
the drum
got the
slowly.
Job because he could play. He could play great.
With Bobby De Niro, yeah. Bobby was the catcher.
So baseball has been like
a threat, exactly.
Yeah,
baseball.
Sports in general, because Danny fought as a kid. I mean, he was a boxer. He was always athletic.
That's right. And you bring that to your the screen.
I love to put things. I love to do little things that indicate what I was capable of doing when I was younger.
Yeah.
You do it and do the right thing.
Yeah.
Remember when he throws the money at Spike?
I wanted people to show I was a baseball player. I would say, I go one.
Oh yeah, yeah.
Two.
Yeah.
I wanted people to see I was athletic. So I, you know what I mean.
So you directed yourself in that scene to be able to do that.
Do you know what I wrote? Do you have any idea how much I wrote?
I don't think I know.
The whole speech. I built this place with my bare hands.
Oh, yes, I did know that. I did know that.
But
right.
Most everything I say in the movie, he gave me permission to do.
Yeah,
but I wrote it before coming, you know, I didn't just arbitrarily.
Right, it wasn't improv. Right. You wrote it yourself. You said, this feels right to me.
He knew it before I did it, because I wanted him to know. I didn't want to do anything to surprise him. He wanted it written. So I wrote it, and he allowed it to be. That was the goodness of Spike. The reason I didn't do it is because I asked him right from the beginning, I said, Spike, this is not exactly the way I see the character. Would I be able to have some input? I said, I'm not asking you, you know, to write and it's got to be that. Let me submit things to you. If you like it, you keep it. If you don't, throw it away. And I'll write something else until you do like it, you know. He said, you got it. But it wasn't only with me. He did that with other people too. He allowed them to improvise in a thing. All the people brought their characters to life because they brought a lot of themselves to the characters, which he allowed. When you allow that, and beforehand you know what they're going to say, it's like you're writing it. You know what I mean? You're accepting what they're saying. All right, that's good. That's not good. That's good. That's good. Keep it in. So I didn't ask for a writing credit. 29th Street. I wrote my whole part. I didn't get a writing credit. I wrote my whole part because I knew who that guy, George Gallo, did. But I don't force that on anyone. If I'm doing a movie and I think there's a problem, I would say to them at the beginning so they can deal with it or not. But if I don't say nothing, I won't change anything.
Yeah,
Woody Allen used to say to me, make it comfortable for yourself, which I considered an insult. I said, what do you mean, make it? I'm going to do your words exactly. And I did. I didn't say that to him, but that's what I was thinking. You know what the critics said whenever I did a picture? It was like Danny was improvising. But it was his words. You follow?
Yes, I do.
My words.
I do. They came out.
So that made me feel good that I interpreted his way the way it should have been, you know.
That's so interesting.
Hurley Burley. You know what I did in Hurley Burley.
But it depends on some directors are into that, some aren't. Yeah. But he's a smart man, Spike Lee.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Also, yeah.
And Woody Allen, right?
Do the right thing doesn't get done if he said no. Just remember that. Universal doesn't.
I don't know that, Louis. We don't know that.
John Kelly told me that. What are you talking about?
You know, I wanted to know one final thing. This is very important for you to know. This is inside stuff that no one else knows. I might have said it to a couple of people, Louis. I always went around saying that Bobby De Niro didn't want to do it, so he suggested me for the role. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
It didn't happen.
Wait, we're talking about
Do the Right Thing. He asked Bobby De Niro to do the role. Bobby De Niro turned it down. And I was told, I don't know if it was by Spike or who it was, that Bobby suggested you. Now, Bobby was a friend of mine, so I thought, well, that's possible. We found out later that Bobby suggested someone else for the role. The worst actor, and I'm not mentioning his name.
Okay, you can't say that.
Because you wouldn't know him anyway. He was an extra. So what I'm saying to you is Bobby, when approaching this script, thought that the script was not up to par for him or any actor, so he suggests this guy who's a terrible actor who might be fitting for this role. You know what I mean?
So he was saying it's a shitty movie, and I'm not even going to say that Danny should be in it because he's too good for that.
Yeah, I'm saying that Bobby never suggested me.
Yeah, I gotcha. I got it.
He never suggested me. I can only put it at that. I can't say why he did something.
But
why would Bobby turn it down? Now, maybe Bobby was busy. Could be that. Or he just didn't think it was for him. Whatever. But we were told that he recommended this guy who always works in every film with him with a small part. He's not a terrible actor, but...
Can you just whisper it? I don't even know who that is. Okay.
Check the billing and you'll look at him and you'll see him in a film. He's in almost every film.
All right.
He's in a little part. Did you get that?
I got it. I heard it.
Okay.
But nobody else is going to hear it.
All right, but that's all right.
Okay. So
I just want you to know it so you can find out.
Yes, I want to know.
That's the person he suggested. He suggested
him. Dan, same one who gave the information, that was from John. John told us that.
Okay.
John who?
Killick.
The producer, that's where we got it from. Who told us? The producer.
Who was the line producer of Do the Right Thing?
Told you what happened with Bobby De Niro.
Right.
Got it. All right.
He was close to Spike. He was the line producer.
Come here.
Got it.
His name is Big Producer.
Oh, okay. All right.
Oh, I'm so happy you clarified.
Now it makes sense. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
How did I find you?
I said that about Universal because he.
Right. Wait, come closer. Oh, you're rolling away from me with these rollers on the chair. Okay,
that's good. Anyway, that's it.
All right, I got it. So that's the inside scoop.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
When you say it wouldn't have been made without me.
No, I didn't say that.
No, you didn't say that. You said it.
I don't believe that.
You said we don't really know that. But you said it's true.
Louis always believes that.
Okay, I got it.
He believes a lot of good things about me that I don't believe.
So
but he makes it good, you know.
So what about he's a good...
He's the greatest guy in the world.
I know. I read you put him in the book. I read about it. I was like, oh, I know Louis.
Louis's the greatest. I keep telling him, I said, him and his wife should have had children because he'd be the best father imaginable. We had that talk last night, me and Louis.
Really?
He's a great father. His wife is a dog lover, which I am. She takes care of dogs. You can't believe her. She dresses the dogs up, sends them
speak. Claudia also choreographed all of Danny's music.
All the videos that I have, she does the dancing.
Great dancer, great choreographer.
I don't even know if the kids see.
You mentioned her in the book too, right?
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Well, this is how we met because we did the first music video.
Right, because I read the book a while ago. I did it probably soon after we met. So this is why it's still, I remember a lot of it, but not every detail, but
she's
now that you say
kid,
that.
She's a good kid, isn't she?
Yeah.
This is my therapist from now on, you know that. This is very empowering for me to get this out. She got it out of me.
Wait till it's on the cover of the New York Times.
It's not.
Says Spike Lee's a piece of shit.
No,
you
I
will
know.
Never, I promise
never.
You,
she
you
would
never have
that.
To worry about anything like that. No. And the only thing I ever do for the New York Times is the Sunday routine section.
Honey, but that's wonderful. New York Times.
You do the
I did that before I did this. To me, this is my thing. So I don't even care. The New York Times, I've written for, I started, you want to know my story? So I was a therapist first, right? I had my practice, and then I started writing on the side. So I started writing for magazines and newspapers, little local ones, like in New Jersey. And then I kept going up. So I started interviewing people, like celebrities a little bit, but like smaller ones. And I really liked it because I'm a therapist and I like to know people's stuff, right? So I like to get into this.
Yeah.
So I started writing more and more, and then I just kind of specialized in this interviewing actors. So for the New York Times, all I do for them is like the Sunday routine column.
Right.
So you've read it probably. It's a Sunday routine with somebody from the city, from any of the boroughs, and what they usually do on a Sunday, what a typical Sunday is.
Wow.
So I did this with Spike. So I've done it with Rappaport. I did Michael Rappaport.
Michael talks.
I know.
He made me the viral all over the.
I know. Well, Michael was on my the podcast too.
Wow.
So I've had Michael on the show.
Did you talk about me at all?
Of course we did.
Oh, good.
By the way, do you know how we ended up? Danny thought he was insulting you.
I know. He told me last time.
Danny said, find out who this guy fights.
So I'm going to kick the shit out.
And I said, look, I said, I'm just warning
you.
You cut the shit because Dan, oh, no, I know. I'm not, you know.
Right.
He was like, he was so.
He worships you.
Yeah, he was so.
Right?
He does.
I went back and told Danny. And I said, but Danny, he also said he'd love to have you on the show. So then we started thinking, Danny said, yeah, I think I'll do it.
Yeah.
But he every time he impersonates me, he curses like, oh,
I know, but there's another guy doing you,
I
too.
Know,
do you know Nicky Petito?
Yeah, I don't know him, but I know that he's doing
it. Well, he's good, too. And he, but every time he said he did it.
What does he do? Is
he's a comedian. He's a stand-up. He's a stand-up. But Spike Lee liked it. So this is what happened. Do you know this story about Spike
Lee?
No,
I don't know.
All right. So right before the Oscars. This is when I met Spike. It was like 4 days before the Oscars, and he was up for the Oscar.
Right.
Two of them. Right? Two,
yeah,
I think.
Yeah, that's right.
So I'm at his office, and I'm like, I can't believe I'm talking to him right before, like, Black Klansman is about to possibly win. And so then I started following Spike on Instagram because I'm interviewing him.
Right.
So I'm watching him on Instagram, and Spike posts a video of this kid, Nicky Petito, doing you. So Nicky is being you, telling Spike, hey, Spike, don't be upset. Don't worry if you don't get the Oscar. Actually, it might have been right after the Oscars. You didn't get the Oscar, but forget it. But I can't do you, but Nicky can, and so can Rappaport. So he's imitating you, or not imitating, whatever the word is. He's impersonating you, talking to Spike, and Spike thought it was so funny that Spike posted it on his Instagram.
Oh my God.
And
meanwhile, Danny and I were rooting for Green Book.
We were rooting for Green Book because my friend wrote.
Of course, I know you mentioned it.
Close friends,
but Spike, that's so funny because, of course, Green Book is bad for Spike because it's like driving Miss Daisy.
Yes.
Every time he
loses,
said
that.
Right?
He told me that.
When he loses, it's to a driving movie.
You're right. You're absolutely right.
So, I mean, he won, but he also lost Best Picture.
Yeah.
So, Nicky Petito kind of got a nice boost after from Spike Lee, and he's really talented. Actually, who he does even better than you, believe it or not, is Tony Soprano.
Oh, right.
I mean, his Tony Soprano will blow you away.
Wow.
You will think it's Gandolfini.
My theory is Gandolfini based Tony Soprano on Danny, meaning he was...
He looked
up to Danny because whenever he would see Danny,
I know the story.
I think when he was taking the character on, he took all of Danny's work that.
You know that I met him when he was he was either 12, 13, or 14. I didn't know I met him on the stage.
Yeah, I remember that story from your book.
When you watch the way the anger in the Soprano character, because it's hidden anger. He's like, when he was asking for too much money, they called up Danny.
Did you know that?
No.
Yeah.
For the place
Tony
Soprano?
They called my agent and asked for my availability, but they were doing it for one reason, to let him know that there was someone else. They didn't want me, they wanted him, and he was asking for a certain amount of money. And they felt that if he found out that other people were in the game, maybe he would.
Especially you.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know, but still, I'll be sad to tell you, when they called me up, in my car from the Post asking me for a quote. And at that time, the actors were giving quotes. So I said, I do not want my name mentioned.
Yeah, yeah.
I do not want a quote. I don't know the man, but I know I would have liked him.
Right.
If I met him, that's what I said, right? And then she told me that the reason I'm calling you is a man by the name of Joe Garofalo, who was your producer, told us that a 12-year-old, I think it was 12, 13, 14, 12-year-old boy came on the stage and was talking to one of the actors on the stage after the show. And that young boy was James Gandolfini, and the actor was you. I didn't remember that.
But
he wasn't an actor then, so everyone would say that that might have struck a note to that boy to become an actor after seeing. That's what they're saying. Same thing 8 years earlier. I honor you.
I thank
you for coming. I said, well, you're welcome, because it was a child catastrophic disease thing. But then Tony, my cousin, told me, Dan, he loves you, and he's a great guy.
That's amazing.
He said he would never do anything to embarrass you. He means what he says.
Yeah.
The DiCaprio thing, he didn't even realize it,
right.
But I saw it, and he chased Danny. It wasn't like he just bumped into us and said, he And when Danny would talk, he was just like staring at him like the little girl.
I was weird. Yeah. Weird. You can show the pictures. So
yeah,
you can see.
I mean, I was standing right there, and I wanted to shut him up. I wanted the kid to kiss him.
Have you got it on the camera?
Send me all the stuff. Send me all the stuff.
Yes, send you the stuff. We're trying to get him to do Pop with me. Yeah, it's a two-character play.
I think he's
I doubt if he'll do it, but we're trying. Yeah,
he's But he's such an actor.
He is terrific.
And I can't believe from like Titanic when he was really just a little boy, right?
Terrific too,
and then now, I think you're going to go see Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yeah, I will because
Gilbert
of him.
Grape?
Never saw that, but yes, that was one of his
really
bigger ones.
I mean, he played
Well, he was in a show called Growing Pains with Alan Thicke.
Wow.
Then that was his first thing, I think.
But the Gilbert Grape was his first film where he actually
He looks a lot like my sons. I don't know if you know that or not. My son Ricky looks like him.
He could play the young Danny in our movie. He could play Danny.
Well, I think that would be really
cool.
And like,
I think he would do it because it's a 50% role, too.
Yeah.
It's not, you know, it's he's all through
and
the
if
movie.
He looks up to you already.
Yeah. We ready?
We're ready. So wait, let's take some pictures. Hold on. Don't get up yet. Okay. We're going to take some pictures.
All right.
Stay right there.
Yes, dog.
I'm going to ask you to say something about...
You.
Yeah, exactly.
Okay, kid.
As you know.
I will.
By the way, Spike was up for 3 Oscars, not 2. Best Adapted Screenplay, which he won. Best Picture and Best Director.
You're gonna say anything you want. You say anything, and you tell me when you're ready.
Look at this beauty. Really Famous.
That's the show you're on right now. It's called Really Famous. So you're famous, but I wanna talk about who you really are.
Yeah.
So that's the play on
And
words.
That you just got that.
Yep.
Okay, babe.
So there we are. All right, so now you say anything you want to. You say, hi, I'm Danny Aiello, and then free ring. All right, tell me when you're ready.
I'm ready.
Good angle here.
Hi, I'm Danny Aiello. I just had the pleasure of, should I call, performing with Kara, one of the great therapists of all time. I had a great time. This is my second interview with her. She came to see me in New York City on Broadway a few years ago. And I remember her since then, and the podcast that she did, or the taping she did, was wonderful. And when she called again to do it again, I didn't hesitate for a moment. I'm doing a movie now. It's called One Moment, and Kara was good enough to come out and say she would love to interview me again on her podcast. Cannot tell you how happy I am, because she does what she calls famous people, but she likes to deal with real issues about real people. I love you, Kara, for what you've done for me. You probably extended my career another couple of years. Thank you, sweetheart.